There are some people, though there is absolutely no reason to do so, but they want to argue whether John 21 really should be in the Gospel of John. And the reason for doing so has nothing to do with any kind of manuscript, textual kind of argument, anything scholarly at all. It's just because chapter 20 seems like such a fitting end, right? You know, Jesus appears, we have the resurrection, and John included those two verses, 30 and 31, you know, these are written that you would believe that Jesus, and, you know, and it just seems like that's how it ought to end. And it's amazing when man thinks that they have the right idea and God somehow was, you know, messed up. But he wasn't. John 21 is in the Bible, believe me. And if we think about it, and that's the problem with these guys, they don't think very well. All four of the Gospels, it's not just that they have the resurrection, but they have some sort of a sending out, if you will, you know, where Jesus is giving those final instructions to them. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all do. John does as well in his own way, as John does throughout his gospel. So Peter is definitely going to be a focus in this last chapter, but not the only focus, of course. And keep in mind, though, this is something we're going to deal with next Wednesday, because we're going to stop before we get to it tonight. The Lord has, you could say, unfinished business with Peter. Now, he's appeared to Peter, you know, he appeared to him all there in the upper room and all, but you remember, Peter denied the Lord three times, and that has to be addressed. If it wasn't for the Gospel of John, and if it wasn't for this chapter in the Gospel of John, we would not know that that ever took place or what took place. And so, again, there's a lot of focus, and Peter is going to be key, but not the only one. So as we get into chapter 21, we read this. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias, that's the Sea of Galilee, and in this way he showed himself. Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, so that's James and John, including, you know, John who wrote this book, and two other of his disciples were together. We don't have them listed for us. Now, right there, that's kind of an interesting detail, though, because we've got Peter, Thomas, Nathanael, James and John, plus two others. So we've got seven disciples here. Judas Iscariot, of course, has taken his own life at this point, but there's 11 left of the original 12 after Judas, and we only got seven listed here. Where are the other four? Now, who knows? Might be very simple, innocent answer, you know, oh, they were going to get food or something. But you get at least a little bit of a picture, I think, of a lack of sort of purpose and unity and focus for these disciples. I mean, these are going to be the ones who, not only have they lived together for so long, but they're going to be the ones that, you know, are the beginning of the church here when we get into Acts. And here we are, we got a few of them here, a few of them there. And of course, where it really shows itself is what takes place as we read in verse 3 now. Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. And they said to him, we're going with you also. And so they went out immediately, got into the boat, and that night they caught nothing. You can see that Peter is still in many ways the leader of the group, right? And, you know, he says, I'm going to go fishing. And they say, yeah, we'll all go with you. And something is up here. Now, I think I have to kind of walk carefully. I do not think that it is accurate to assume the worst of Peter as if he is in full-blown abandonment of being a disciple of Jesus. That's it. I'm done. You know, I'm going to go fishing. Because that's somehow how this is spun. But I do think there is something serious taking place because maybe some of us might want to go fishing. And typically the idea is you're going to relax a little bit, get away from the noise, get away from the crowd. I'm just going to have some time fishing. That's not what we're talking about here, of course. To fish the Sea of Galilee, and remember, we're talking about commercial fishermen, aren't we? That's what they were when Jesus called them. It's not like you're just baiting a hook with a worm and sticking a pole in there and then taking a nap for a few hours waiting for a strike. You got to throw this large net, drag it in against the weight of the water and so forth. Fishing is hard work back then. It was done, the Sea of Galilee was fished at night. Notice the Bible tells us that. So that's another factor in this because, of course, you know, you're used to sleeping at night. And they're going to be up all night fishing. Not to mention the fact that they've been walking with the Lord for 3.5 years, and probably with only a few exceptions, they haven't been regularly fishing, and I know I can relate to this. Your muscles aren't quite in the same shape when they haven't been doing that kind of work. In other words, this is a difficult evening. This is not leisure. This is not, let's just do something on board. So there is something going on. As I said, I don't think we want to, you know, just assume the worst intentions of them. But I do also think that it is interesting that it says that night they caught nothing. Nothing. This was of their own idea, wasn't it? This was their own desire. We don't see the Lord telling them to go fishing. This is just their own thought. And they were completely unsuccessful. Didn't catch a thing. So, as we get now into verse 4, when the morning had now come, Jesus stood on the shore, yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Then Jesus said to them, "Children, have you any food?" Now, in the Greek, the way this is written, it is a sort of question where the assumption, the implication is a no. I think you could translate this, "You didn't catch anything, did you?" kind of thing, right? In other words, the assuming is, you know, do you have any food? It's not like, yes, maybe you do. It's like, you don't have any food, do you? You didn't catch anything, huh? That's what he said. So they answered him, no. And then he said to them, "Cast the net on the right side of the boat and you will find some." So they cast, and now they were not able to draw it in because of the multitude of fish. Therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved, that's John, how he describes himself, says to Peter, "It's the Lord." Now, when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he had removed it, and he plunged into the sea. I know, I think the old King James says because he was naked, but it's not naked in the sense of bare naked or whatever, but the idea was stripped down to just his inner garment as he was fishing and doing all that work. Now he puts his outer garment on. It might seem weird, like, why would you put more clothes on when you're about to dive into the water? But he's going to go meet Jesus. You know, you don't want to show up in what we might call your underwear or whatever, right? I mean, that's the idea there, respect. So he puts on his outer garment, plunges into the sea. The other disciples came in the little boat, for they were not far from land. It says, but about 200 cubits. It says, now that's not far from land. And I guess on the totality of the Sea of Galilee, 200 cubits is not that far. But 200 cubits... And if you remember in the Bible, a cubit is approximately 18 inches or 1.5 feet. So it's really easy whenever you see anything given in cubits, if you can do 1.5 pretty quickly in your head, you know that you're dealing with basically 300 feet here. And if you're into football, you know 300 feet, 100 yards, so that's a length of a football field. So no wonder they didn't recognize him on the shore. I mean, that's a pretty good distance, and it's early morning. The sun's just breaking and so forth. But what got the attention? Cast the net on the right side, you'll find some. They did it, and then they had this, after fishing all night and catching nothing, they had this miraculous catch of fish. And that's why John says, "It's the Lord." No doubt a flashback, right? To the very early days when they were just meeting Jesus. And they had another experience where they tried to fish all night, didn't catch anything. And Jesus said, "Oh, let's go back out again." Even though it's daytime, even though they had already gotten out and, you know, cleaned the nets or whatever. "All right, I'll humor you, Lord. I'll throw down a net." And remember, it was just a miraculous catch once more. And so here they have this a similar situation take place. They're again about 100 yards from the shore. and they're dragging the net with all the fish. So verse 9 says, then as soon as they had come to land, they saw a fire of coals there, fish laid on it, and bread. Now that's not their fish. That's Jesus has already prepared this. And Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish which you have just caught. And Simon Peter went up and dragged the net to land, full of large fish, 153. And although there were so many, the net was not broken. And Jesus said to them, come and eat breakfast. And then it says, none of the disciples dared ask him, who are you, knowing that it was the Lord. Now that's interesting. Again, there seems to be a recognition issue there to some degree, but they know it's him anyway. So Jesus then came and took the bread, gave it to them, likewise the fish. And then John says, now the third time Jesus showed himself to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. So I wanted to get that whole picture there of what took place. Now, as I said, when we go through the scripture and we seek to try to find various application things, this is an example for me that I kind of have fun with, because it's an example of what not to do when trying to study your Bible. Now, let me preface this, and where I'm going, by the way, is the question, and some of you may have it as well, what's the significance of 153? It says he caught 153 fish. Now, we affirm without hesitation, all Scripture is God-breathed, given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for us, for doctrine, instruction, and righteousness. It's profitable. Every word in the Bible is there because God wants it there. And so every word is significant, you could say. Because who's going to say, well, we don't need those words? God's word, he wanted them in there. So having said that, though, we, I believe, have to be careful, and I've seen far too many examples, and some of you have as well, of doing too much what we might call allegorizing of the text, or trying to make all sorts of deep spiritual lessons out of little details in the Bible where that sort of thing is really not warranted. And the issue I have with that so often is that basically then you can make the Bible mean anything you want it to mean. And that's a dangerous place to be. Now, there is no doubt that the Bible has a lot of symbolism, has what we call these types, and many of those are clearly explained for us. Some, I think, show themselves to us, and God speaks to our hearts about it. But once more, sometimes a river is a river in the Bible, and sometimes a mountain is a mountain. And if you read some of the commentators who really get into allegorizing, I mean, they'll find a simple passage and it says, and there was a parting with two rivers down there. It was like, those two rivers are law and grace, you know, and they give you some big sermon on that. No, it's just two rivers. Now, if God spoke to your heart in some sort of devotional way about that, then I'm not going to argue with that, but if you're teaching that this is what God's trying to communicate to all of us, then you've gone too far, you see. So we have to be careful of that. Now, throughout John's gospel, we have seen John give us details that only an eyewitness would have. And we've pointed several of those out. Like, see, these are the words of someone who was there, knows the specifics, and gives sort of little things that someone who was just sharing a story would not necessarily think to give. When the perfume was broken, he says, oh, the smell filled the room. These are the kind of things that he remembered. And we have a miraculous catch of fish. And boy, if you're a professional fisherman, or you were a professional fisherman, I guess in their case, you know what a miraculous catch of fish is like. And they knew they had one. And if you're reading 153 fish, and yet the net didn't even break, you would say, that's a miracle, and that's what we're supposed to get out of this. Of course, this is a miracle from the Lord, no doubt about it. Now, fishermen count their fish in such a situation, and especially since I would assume they're going to divide these up, since there were several of them that were fishing. It's not like they all belong to Peter. then it makes sense that you would count them up for the purpose of, you know, dividing it, or okay, here's how we're going to split the money, or whatever they're going to do down the road. Again, that's not written about, but and they counted it out 153, and John remembered that, and John includes it for us. Now, that's how I think it's that simple. I think it's just another example of John giving us a detail. But here is, by example, the sort of thing that you can see applied in all sorts of other places of the Bible that I personally, as the pastor here, really encourage us to avoid doing when we study the Bible. And you know, I'm all about studying and teaching the Bible. But let me give you some examples of the, quote, significance of 153 fish, according to others in the past. There was an old church father. I guess he's considered a father. He's kind of at the borderline of when we talk about the church fathers in the 300s, early 400s, named Jerome. Jerome's probably biggest claim to fame is his translation into Latin of the Bible, known as the Latin Vulgate, which was a very influential translation for so many years. Well, Jerome also taught a lot, and he said that there were 153 different species of fish, and that they caught one of each. And this is told us to show how the gospel is going to go into every nation of the world, and therefore people from every tribe and tongue and so forth will all become believers. Now, if God was trying to communicate such a thing, that's a pretty hard way to do it. How many readers would have thought of that? Now, let's backtrack a little bit. There's thousands of species of fish. I mean, right there, it's just way wrong. And God's never wrong. You say, well, they didn't know that back then. Well, God knew it. But nevertheless, actually, there was a Roman historian in the time of John named Pliny. Many of you have heard of him. One of the things that he studied was fish. And he actually gave a number of how many species of fish, and it wasn't 153. It was a different number. Now, it was kind of in the ballpark, so you could say, well, you know. But still, no one would say, oh, yeah, 153 fish. That's what Pliny's been saying. No, no one would have made that connection, you see. So it's wrong scientifically, because there's far more fish than that, different types of fish. It wasn't even incorrectly believed back in those days, necessarily. Plus, why would we have to come up with this idea of, in the Sea of Galilee, no less, every single species of fish was found at this one catch? Come on. The Bible has enough miracles and enough things for us to believe and give glory to God, then we don't have to make things up. But you see, this is what I'm talking about, allegorizing, and Jerome was big at it when you read some of his stuff. And this is a good example. Now, let me give you another example. Some have noted that in the Greek language of the New Testament, now, this was a characteristic of the Greek language, and this gets Christians into all sorts of trouble. Greek language had a numerical value system to each letter in their alphabet. We don't really do that in English, but they did. And so different letters go down the Greek alphabet, had different numerical values. And the problem with that is you start taking a word, you can add up the numerical values. Well, someone noted that if you take Simon's name and you turn it into numerical values for each letter and you add up the number, you get a number. And then you take the word fish and you do the same thing, you add it up, and then you put them together, guess what? You get 153. So God's trying to tell us that Peter is a divine fisherman or something. I mean, what are they trying to say with that? You know, but again, you see, that's the sort of thing I'm talking about, how you can make it. There's no way that God's trying to communicate that to his people throughout the world, throughout history. I'll give you a final example again just to finish this off. But you see, those are two very different things, by the way. What Jerome taught about the species of fish, and no, you got to look at the letters and the numbers. No, you don't have to do either. And you don't have to do this third one either. In mathematics, you can take any number And then you can add all of the numbers up to that number and get a number. In other words, if you take, and I'll give you an example, the number 4, you can say 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4, and you get what? 8? No, 10. Doing that on the spot there. 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4, and you know. Well, if you take the number 17, and you go 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5, you know, plus 14, 15, 16, and you get the whole way through, you add it all up, you can imagine, what number do you get? 153. If you use 17, it's like, why use 17? What's the important about that? There's no 17. Oh, 17. 10, the commandments, the law. 7, the sevenfold spirit of grace. The, you know, and you take 10, you take 7, you get 17, and then you divide the 17 thing and you get 153, and that's what God's trying to teach his people throughout the ages. We don't need to do that to the Bible. And sometimes it has been my observation, now to get us to like the current days, that when I've run into the occasional Christian who is really, really, really overly focused on those type of games within the text, it's a judgment, I know, maybe I shouldn't make it, but it's an observation that there seems to be a very low interest in the deeper spiritual lessons that God's trying to teach us about walking with him, about being forgiving, about being serving, about being loving, about being gracious, being merciful. You know, the things that we learn, things that have to do with the fruit of the Spirit and so forth. There's so much. Did you know, Pastor, that if you take this and you take this and you go back here and you go back there and you get this? And I'm like, come on, man. God's not trying to communicate that way to you. So, like I said, it's an example of kind of what not to do in studying your Bible, because we see 153. I think John's just given us a detail. I really think it's as simple as that. Now, if someone says, no, here's the significance of 153, and they can come up with a fourth idea. I gave you three, and we throw all three of those out, come up with the fourth one. But then someone's going to come up with a fifth, and someone's going to come up with a sixth, because we can make the Bible mean anything we want to. And God doesn't want us to do that with his word. Remember when Paul warned Timothy about how, you know, arguments over endless genealogies and all this kind of stuff? He says, avoid all that stuff, Timothy. You're a servant of God. Don't get down that road. That's not to say that the Bible doesn't have incredible things that we can discover, we can learn, and God speaks to our heart in powerful ways. And in this story here, I want you to notice three details here. First of all, again, Jesus is directing their activity now. Remember I said when they went out and they didn't catch anything, that was just their own doing, right? Now Jesus is saying, throw the net over there. He's directing their activity. They're obeying him. And in their obedience, the second thing is we see the Lord blesses them. Blesses them with an incredible catch. Again, it's not the really focus of the story, but this would be worth some money. I mean, you know, this is a big deal. So the Lord directs them and the Lord blesses them. And yet, even in all of that, the third thing to note by the detail when they got there is, but the Lord had already provided for their needs, hadn't he? The Lord had the food ready to go. He said, well, here, why don't you add some of what you caught to it? Did the Lord need them? Oh, boy, I was going to go hungry if, you know, he hadn't shown up and cut this. No. And I think that's a good reminder for us as well. And again, it's a principle that's rooted throughout the Bible. God doesn't need us. We're blessed and privileged that he chooses to involve us, to use us. But if he's going to involve us and use us, then what? We have to obey. We got to be led by him, don't we? He needs to direct the activity as he does here. And he will bless the obedience. Now, here we have, you know, you could say a big prosperity blessing. That's not always how it goes down, but the blessing will be there from obedience. But once more, ultimately, he doesn't need us. We need to let the Lord direct us, trust that he will bless us in our obedience, but know that he's the one who provides. It's not, quote, up to us, you see. And to kind of now bring it full circle here, because my desire was not to get into the restoration of Peter, which is going to be also kind of a lengthy thing that comes in the next few verses. To bring it full circle here, though, as I said, the Lord didn't tell them to go fishing. And I mentioned at the beginning, it's interesting that John says there were seven of them, four of them weren't there, and you know, it seems like they're just kind of hanging around looking at their watch, stuff they didn't have watches, but you know what I mean. I'm going to go fishing. And there was just something about the vibe of this passage. Yeah, we'll go with you. One of the challenges we have is waiting on the Lord. Remember, the Lord directs the activity. The Lord gives the orders. You remember what we were talking about on Sunday? How the Lord is like the commander over the whole thing, and he is giving orders. He might give different orders to this Christian, different orders to that one, and so forth. But to wait on the Lord is something that is not always that easy, and yet doesn't the Bible mention that many, many, many times and many places? Wait on the Lord. One of my examples I like to use is when we're going through the book of Genesis and we're reading the life of Abraham, and Abraham had such a deep, rich relationship with God, didn't he? And the Lord appeared to Abraham and he said, and we read this like, wow, you know. But if you look carefully, you realize that you can go from one chapter to another and you just pass like 19 years. The Lord appeared to Abraham, and he said this, da, da, da. And then next chapter, and the Lord appeared to Abraham again. And you think, wow, that's so great. 19 years went by, and the Lord didn't say anything to Abraham in any direct, dramatic way, at least. And how about Moses? Moses' life, 120 years. And it's very easy to remember this division. He was 40 years in Egypt. We also know the wilderness wandering was 40 years, right? After they got out of Egypt. What was the middle time when he was out in the desert, which was also 40 years? He left Egypt and he went out and he was just a shepherd, got married, just living his life, just sitting out there day after day after day in the heat, and 40 years. Was waiting, and then the Lord gave him orders there at the burning bush. Abraham, silence for a long time, and then the Lord gives orders. And that's how it is right. Now, waiting on the Lord doesn't mean, you know, what's on TV today, I'm just going to lie on the couch. It means doing the things that he's already called us to do. We know in terms of family, in terms of work, in terms of just those basics, like worshiping him and so forth. But in terms of the bigger things or the more dramatic, the chapter turnings in our life, right? Something new's about to happen. Something different's about to take place. We often want to rush the Lord. I'm itching to go now. Then the Lord says, wait. Wait, because now's not the time. When we try to get ahead of the Lord, nothing good's going to happen. Let me backtrack this. The Bible says that we have to be faithful in little things, right? And then God begins to unfold and entrust us with bigger things. That's a principle of how God works with his people. You can't avoid it and deny it. It's a principle. If you want to call it a spiritual law, so to speak, right? And that's, again, the whole idea of the waiting, because, like, I'm tired of this. Like, I'm doing the same old thing, and it's just so, you know, trivial or whatever. And, well, it's kind of important, though. Yeah, but anyone could do this. So it's like, yeah, but God wants you to do it right now. Be faithful in the little things. Now, when I went to school of ministry, that was the thing before my seminary, but the two-year thing, I mentioned this the other day in a message. For 2 years of the school of ministry, there at Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa, being equipped to become a pastor. That was the point of the school of ministry back then when I was there. It was a 2-year program. It was heavy academics and Bible study, but it was also practical stuff. We had to work in the church office. We had to go to the prayer room. We had to be involved in a home Bible study. We had to have a teaching ministry somewhere. I mean, there was a lot that we had to do. And the idea was, this is all part of the equipping process. You got to know your Bible, so we got to study the Bible. You got to know what you're talking about up there, but you also have to serve and to be there and to pray with people and to do grunt work at the church office and all that kind of stuff. Okay, for 2 years. And it was a challenging program because the classes met from 7 a.m. to 10 a.m. And so then you had to go to work and do all your other stuff and sometimes find time to do the homework and all the rest of it. Okay. From start day one in class, in the next month or so, we typically have, 35-40%, maybe half the people drop out. Because the idea is like, look, if God has called you to this, this is going to be tough either way. If God's called you, then you make the decision to stick it out. If he hasn't called you, this is something in your head, like, I want to be a pastor someday, I think I'll go to school minister, then drop out now. Because if God's not in it, it's going to be a disaster for you, for your family, if you have one, and so forth. And so we would have a lot of people, and there's no shame in that. All right, so now you fast forward, and it's graduation. Well, the thing about the school of ministry is it's not like, congratulations, you're now a pastor, we ordain you, and we send you out to this church that's got 200 people here, and you're the senior pastor, congrats. That's not what the school is about at all. It was just about equipping. Now you're back on your own with the Lord. And I remember the idea of having a teaching ministry or being part of a home fellowship or doing some of those little things. In my case, I taught at that nursing home that I've shared with you before. It was a nursing home for senile dementia people, Alzheimer's and other forms of dementia. And I would lead the Sunday church service for them. Very simple. And, did that for several years. And I remember from time to time, if I was out of town trying to find someone to substitute for me, and, some people just didn't want to do it. And sometimes I would get someone who would do it, and they said, oh, I'm never doing that again, man. I don't know how you do that every week. It's like, what? They don't bite your head off. I mean, they sleep through the message most of the time. I mean, what was the problem? It was just the idea of being around elderly people who can and might yell at you or might think you're their uncle or your nephew or and they just couldn't handle it. It's like, that's ministry, man. But in any event, when it was time for me to move on from that after several years, thank the Lord that he brought a guy who had the same kind of heart and passion for that work. And he was able to step in, and I was grateful. But here's why I'm telling all this story. That was just one example. But of all those men who, they didn't drop out. They stuck it out the whole 2 years. The faithful brothers, side by side, we're all getting equipped. We're all learning. Because, again, at graduation day, it's like, all right, guys, have a good life kind of thing. And the doors didn't part. You just say, well, here, you're going on staff. Here's your paycheck. And none of that happened. And some guys knew exactly what they wanted to do at graduation. Well, there was one brother. He's still serving the Lord today in Japan. He was from Japan. He came to California for 2 years to go to that school, rented a little apartment, had a little furniture. On the day of graduation, he sold all his stuff, and he and his wife got back on a plane and went back to Japan. That was his whole purpose, to go back to his people and start a church out there. And he's still serving the Lord today. Guy like him, he knew exactly what he was doing. There was a few other guys like that. Says, yeah, I'm on staff already at this one church. I wanted to get equipped, though, so I'd have a better idea of what I'm doing and so forth. But there were guys like me. Like, what now? And I tell people this all the time. I tell all of you. Lord just spoke to my heart. Just keep serving where you're at. Keep serving where you're at. Knock on an occasional door. See if it opens. The Lord opens it. Okay. The Lord opened many doors. I'm not going to tell you my whole life story following him, but the point is that you just keep serving where you're at, faithful in the little things. But I'm sorry to say that of my graduating class, many, many of the men, after a few years, I'd ask about them. They weren't doing anything for the Lord. I mean, it's not like they weren't Christians anymore, but it was just like, what are they doing? I don't know. I guess they still go to church, but there's just nothing there because they got discouraged and they just you could say, gave up. After all that equipping, after all that commitment, after all that time, because why? They couldn't wait on the Lord. At least that's my conclusion. And that can be a challenge for any of us. And I think right here, we see the Lord really stepping in at what might be a pivotal moment, say that three times fast, in their lives. Like I say, I don't think we want to assume that Peter's abandoning the Lord. That's it, I'm done with this stuff. I don't think we want to go that far. But I think he's like, maybe I need to go back to my old job. You know, maybe I need to see what fishing's like again. I don't know if he's just kind of in that gray area. It's open to interpretation, I realize that part. But then the Lord steps in, reminds him what it's all about. And we also have the other issue going on. And again, next week we'll cover it. It was one of those things like, well, if we try to cover all this in 1 week, we'll be here all night or we won't do it justice. But we take it over 2 weeks. But next week, we also have that issue of Peter's restoration. What's going on in Peter's head at this point? Peter knew that he had denied the Lord three times. He wept bitterly when the realization struck him. And if you recall, after the third denial, he actually made eye contact with the Lord, because when the Lord was being moved from one place to another during those trials in the night, and he saw him. We have no idea the kind of look the Lord must have given him. But if you remember, the Lord predicted this, prophesied, you're going to deny me three times. Peter said, I'll never do that. Wrong, Peter. And the Lord was right. And when the realization hit Peter, oh, I've done exactly what Jesus said I was going to do. And then he sees Jesus right there and they make eye contact. That's the sort of thing that could really destroy a guy. And yes, the Lord appeared to the disciples there in the upper room and, you know, says, here, touch me and all that. But we don't see any direct thing with Peter. I wonder if Peter was kind of silent and quiet. We saw him being the first to race to the empty tomb when he heard that it was empty, when the women said, oh, you know, they've taken the body. And he went running to check it out and everything. I mean, he's got that passion. But in terms of just talking to the Lord, he hasn't really had that yet. And the Lord's got big plans for Peter. But it's going to take a restoration first. And we're going to look at the details of restoration next week. But just as we close here for us, again, the Lord wants to direct us, and we need to obey his direction. And we need to wait for his orders while we're continuing to be faithful in the little things that he's got us already doing in our lives, whatever they may be. They don't have to be necessarily super spiritual stuff, just living for Jesus in our lives, being a loving servant of others who is quick to forgive, who's quick to show mercy, who speaks the truth in love, on and on and on. That's what it means to be a follower of Christ. But if there are those times when, like Peter, we know, boy, have I blown it. We need to have that restoration time. And the Lord is always there for that restoration. We don't have to wait. Like, well, when's he going to come get me? No, we go to him. Our great high priest, we're told in the book of Hebrews. He knows what it's like down here. And you see, that's the thing. Jesus predicted that Peter would deny him. He knew it in advance. That's what hurt Peter so much, because Peter was so quick, I'll never do. There might be some things in our lives that we would say, I would never do that. I love Jesus too much. I would never do that. And we might find ourselves doing it. And we think, how could I have let down the Lord so much? But remember, the Lord knows any sin, any disobedience that you might do for the rest of your life. He knows it now. We may think when we are at the spiritual mountaintop and we are just so filled with the Spirit because we've been walking with the Lord and maybe we had a great discussion with someone about Christ or there was just some moment where we were just connected and we just think, oh, It's like I'm on heaven on earth. And we may think, oh, I've gotten victory over so much and all the rest of it. And we may just be, and the Lord knows this is wonderful. In 2 months, in 2 years, in 2 hours, you know, whatever. But you're going to fall right on your face. Because the Lord knows the end from the beginning, doesn't he? Nothing surprises him. Nothing shocks him. He knows it all. So what happens? Do we really disappoint Jesus when we fall on our face whenever that time comes? No, because he already knew it was going to happen. And he loves us, and he gave us this wonderful experience where we were on the spiritual mountaintop, because I couldn't do that. Good thing I'm not God, as you all say amen. Because if I knew someone's going to stab me in the back, if I knew someone's going to deny my name, if I knew someone was going to mistreat me or whatever, and yet we're all buddy buddies over here, that knowledge would affect how I was in the here and now, right? But again, God isn't like us. And so all that love and all that grace he pours out in those spiritual, but he knows where we might fall. And so we don't disappoint him. Who do we disappoint? Disappoint ourselves. I thought I was beyond that, Lord. I thought I had gotten the victory over that. I thought that would never happen to me again. That happened to me and you. And the Lord knows, but he loves us. He loves us anyway. And the Lord loves Peter. And what's more, the Lord still uses us. Well, the Lord will never use me now. Wrong. The Lord still uses us, and he's going to use Peter. But again, we have to get right. And the Bible tells us how to get right. Confess our sins. He's faithful, just to forgive us our sins, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And next Wednesday, we're going to see Peter get right, if you will, with this meeting that he's going to have with Jesus. It must have been an interesting breakfast, you know. Unfinished business still that's kind of there. You know, what they call it, the elephant in the room kind of thing, the elephant on the sand. But the Lord's going to deal with him. So we're going to close it right there. Let's pray. Lord, we're so grateful for your work in our lives, that you want to direct our lives. You want to give us commands as to how we are to live our lives and what we are to do and what we are to say and where we're to live and where we're to go. Every detail, Lord. There's nothing that's insignificant in our lives in your sight. You count the very hairs on our head. And yet, Lord, we know how in our sin, in our self, our pride, other aspects of our fallen nature, we want to do things our way. We want to think we know best sometimes. We want to get ahead of you sometimes. Or we just want to go astray. And we know that those are going to be fruitless times, but we might do them anyway. Help us, though, Lord, to learn the lesson right here in John 21. That you direct our activity and you bless the efforts. And may we always be reminded that though you want to use us, and Lord, we want to be used, but you don't need us, for you are Lord. You are the King of the universe. You are sovereign over all things. And help us to remember, Lord, that you know the end from the beginning, all things. And rather than may that be terrorizing to us, may it bring us great comfort, Lord. Because even though you know all things, you know our deepest, darkest core, you love us anyway, and you're gracious to us, and you bless us, and Lord, we're so thankful. Watch over us, we humbly ask, as we go from this place tonight. Keep us safe on our rides home and in the days ahead of us, Lord. And again, use us even in the routine, even in the normal things of life. May we hear your voice in all of it, and bring glory to your name as your witnesses. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.